So then the question happens, what happens? So here he is, he makes a critical decision. He decides, I'm going to take, between the girl and the money, I'm going to take the money. And we get to see the result of his action. We get to see in the third act here, what we'll see is we get to see the new problems that crop up due to his critical decision. So we get to see maybe new problems, maybe we get to see if he solved any problems. Maybe for all we know, he chooses the money and it turns out the girl's a gold digger and loves him, right? And he gets the girl as well. So that can be a situation, that's totally unexpected. It's not sort of like, oh, I'll get the girlfriend and that's the end of that, right? It's you can have a situation like that. So but then he faces new problems. It turns out that she's a gold digger and she wants to take all his money. These are new problems that are faced due to the critical decision. So he has to act to solve these problems due to his critical decision. And this is what makes up the third act, the third and final act. But mind you, the thing is that you may have a whole new quest, a whole new intent, a whole new situation, in which case we re-enter the cycle. We re-enter the cycle of having to solve these problems. And if there are new problems and things that aren't cleaned up, we can create another story arc. Our story can continue. We can go on to Act 4, Act 5, Act 6, Act 7, until we run out of problems to solve, until there's nothing that we haven't covered. And this is how, things like sitcoms are born, is that when there's always one problem after the next. But the important thing is that you always keep things linked together. You don't have this sort of fragmented episodic format. So that's how you really get people roped up into a story. So let's talk about a little case study here. I've quickly concocted a little story I called about the loan shark. So in the first scene, I'm going to have the first beat. Let's imagine that we have a loan shark is waiting on the roof of an apartment to meet a man to collect a payment, right? So he's going to meet a debtor, a guy who owes him money to collect payment. And so this is his intent. This is what he's doing. This is what this is like the first thing that we see. We just see a guy who's waiting on the roof of an apartment. We don't know he's a loan shark just yet. But anyway, the guy arrives, and we'll know he's a loan shark because he's going to say, "Hey, where's the money?" Oh, okay, obviously, we know who's who. And so the man is going to show. So this is the action that the loan shark takes, requesting payment from the debtor. And the other thing is that this scene, now that we know that he's here to collect payment, we know who our protagonists are. We know what his intent is. Our scene is going to finish when he gets his money. Or he winds up in a situation where he can't get his money, one or the other. So anyway, the guy arrives. He asks for the money. This is the action, and what happens as a result? Well, the guy shows the loan shark some photographs that he's using to blackmail the loan shark. Aha! So by asking for money, the man has suddenly escalated the situation. The situation has suddenly gotten worse. New problems have come up because now it turns out that the loan shark is going to be blackmailed with these photographs. So a new intent arrives, a new intent, and the new intent is that the loan shark has to break the leverage of the debtor so he can get paid. He wants his money back, right? So, with these photographs. So what does he do about the photographs? Well, he snatches the photographs. But then as a result, the debtor, the guy who owes him money, tackles him. They're at the rooftop, he tackles him. But the loan shark dodges. He dodges the debtor, and the debtor tumbles over the edge. He goes falling off the rooftop. Now, oh shoot, we got ourselves a new problem here because the loan shark can't retrieve payments from a dead guy. So what does he do? I mean, while the guy's tumbling over the edge, he snatches at the debtor's hand and he stops the guy from falling. So this is, he's gone and he's done something to solve the problem. Excellent. So now the debtor now owes the loan shark his life, along with owing him all that money. And so the loan shark's gonna milk this for all it's worth. He's gonna say, "Where's my money? I want my money, right?" So the debtor tells the loan shark, if you want your money, you can get it from a swindler. Haha. So the thing is that the debtor has no money. He's got no money for this guy. And he says that someone else has it. So the loan shark, unfortunately, he has his own weaknesses. He gets really, really pissed off from this. You see, the things that a person's emotions can act as a problem itself, right? So he's overcome with rage, and he releases the debtor from his debts. He lets him go. He lets him fall to his death, right? He even though this works against him, he's just so pissed off that he lets the guy fall and he dies. So, oh shit, the guy's dead. You know, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? So what do is we go, you know, the loan shark has to track down the guy who's actually got the money, because the loan shark's got his own problems. He owes other people money. For all we know, you know, like there's a big boss up there, you know, that he owns a ton of money to. So if he doesn't get this money back, he's really screwed. So anyway, he goes to track down, he must, his intent is to track down the swindler. So the next action is the loan shark, he enters a bar and he asks the bartender about the late debtor's acquaintances. You know, he wants to know, who is this guy hanging out with? Who is this guy hanging out with? He wants to know who had the money. So, you know, he gets the bartender, you know, gives him a name and an address, you know. So anyway, he goes and he tracks him down. You know, we got to think, you know, think ahead. What happens? You know, who is this swindler? So it turns out that the swindler happens to be the man who took the photographs, the guy who took the, who shot the photographs, you know, to blackmail, you know, the this loan shark. So, you know, it's this is, you know, this is another result, right? This is a new intent. He's got to go and he's got to find this photographer. So, you know, this we can keep on going. We can continue on with the cycle and add more and more scenes, you know, to find out what happens next. What happens next? What does this guy want next? And what does he do to get what he wants? And ultimately, you know, we're gonna have to find out how he gets his money and how he deals with the problem of his big boss coming to, you know, bug him for the money. Maybe, you know, he doesn't want to start losing his pinky fingers, start losing his fingers. So these are all situations from a story. This is how a story structure, you know, with a simple structure of figuring out, you know, what does the guy want? What does he do to get it? Does he get what he wants? You know, he doesn't get what he wants. He gets what he wants, or it's more than he bargained for. You know, it's a cycle. It's a simple, very, it's a very simple cycle. And you can do this. It's simple. It's really simple. So anyway, I haven't talked about the storyboards yet. I'll get into that, you know, maybe later on. I'll explain how some of this stuff works, and I'll talk to you guys later.